Okay, so in lesson 6 to 8, we're going to introduce the concept of rational exponents and how those relate to radicals. So first, you're probably asking yourself, well, what is that? You've used radicals before, you just probably call them something different. If you've ever seen this symbol right here, then you've worked with a radical. It's most likely the case that over those last few years, you saw that and you immediately thought, oh, that's a square root symbol. And that's what I hear most commonly students call it, but that's a square root symbol. And that's usually the case. You have the symbol there, you might have a number in here like number 4, and you're like, oh yeah, that means it's a square root of 4, and I know that that's 2, okay? And that's pretty close. But the reality is that the symbol itself is called a radical symbol. And it's only a square root symbol when either you don't see anything up here in this top left corner, or you see a 2 right there. Okay, so if you see the 2 there, then it is a square root. The radical is wanting you to take the second root, or the square root of the number inside. Or, you know, if we don't even bother writing anything right there, then it actually just implies it, kind of like a coefficient of 1, we know it's there, but we don't bother writing it. So if we don't bother writing the index, then you can assume it's automatically a square root. But the reality is that the symbol itself is called a radical, and you can take more than just the square root of a number. You can take just about any you'd like, right? So you have an example here where they're doing the third root, or what we sometimes call the cube root of a number, and that's happening right here. And so you see the index right there showing up with the little number 3 on the top left. That indicates to you that that radical is actually a third root or a cube root, and that they don't just want to know what number times itself twice would give you 8, but they want to know what number times itself 3 times would give you 8, right? So to kind of connect this to what we've been working on, well, we've been working with power stuff, right? Exponents and powers, and essentially radicals undo those exponents, right? The reverse or the inverse operation. So where I, for example, know that 3 squared is equal to 9, then I could take the square root of 9, and that would take us back to 3, okay? So those are inverses or opposites of each other. And now you know that that symbol is not just a square root, but it's a radical. And you could find any root. So just like you can raise numbers to pretty much any exponent, you can take any root, right? So maybe instead of 3 to the 2nd power, we might do 3 to the 4th power, which is 81. Well, just as easily, then I could go in reverse and say, what's the 4th root of 81? And the answer would be 3. So that's how that works, right? They're inverse operations of each other, the exponential part of, or the exponent of power versus the radical, okay? So let's learn a little bit more vocabulary. So when we're looking at the nth root of any number, and it's written in this format right here, okay, that format is called a radical. And in that radical, that number in the top left corner, that n value is called the root. It tells us, you know, how many roots we're looking for. Is it the 2nd root, the 3rd root, the 4th root, and so forth, right? So that's the root of the radical. And then whatever value is inside or underneath the radical sign, that's what we call the radicand. That's your vocabulary right there. So you'll hear me throw those words around, and I just want you to be familiar with what they mean. Okay? So the radical symbol has an index on the top left. Then a lot of times we call the root of the number, and the value underneath is called the radicand. All right, so let's practice that a little bit. This comes up a lot when we're looking at three-dimensional figures, just like area is a two-dimensional value and we end up squaring stuff. Then in 3 dimensions, we end up multiplying 3 things together. So the volume of a cube is usually a good example to kind of see this at play. We know that for a cube, the volume is just equal to the side length of a cube times itself 3 times. Cubed means to the 3rd power, okay? So it's essentially, typically the formula is length times width times height, except for a cube, all 3 of those are the same. So we can just say it's the side length raised to the 3rd power, okay? So we wanna use that cube root symbol to kind of re-express the side length of each of these cubes, and then we can find the actual cube root. So we're going to first rewrite it with radical form, and then we're actually going to evaluate it. Some of these we'll be able to do in our head, and that's great. And some of them are going to be a little bit harder, and we'll use a calculator, so I'll show you how to do that. So let's try number, or letter A, I guess, first. So the volume of this particular cube is 27 cubic feet. And so the first thing I want to do is express what the side length would be if I express it as a cube root. So if the volume is 27, then I know the side length must be the cube root of 27. And then I can evaluate that. And this one, I think most of us can figure this out in our head. What number times itself three times is going to give us 27. We've been working with these a little bit. We probably all can feel comfortable that that is three, and if, or you can kind of guess at it, and then, just kidding, I should not have it. So it would be 3 feet, and then you can kind of test that and say, okay, three times three, that's nine, times another three, that would be 27, so that would work. Okay. Same thing on B here, if the volume is 125 cubic centimeters, then the side length can be expressed as the cube root of 125. And then we can evaluate that. And with that 5 in there, I bet it's going to be 5 centimeters. And then you can check it, and it will be right. 5 times 5 is 25, and then times another 5 is 125. But then we get to letter C here. This number is much bigger, and it's going to be a little bit less intuitive for us to kind of figure this out. Now, we could sit here and guess and check. We could do a factor tree. There's lots of options. But we do have the option of a calculator. So we can just jump right to that. So first, let's write it as a radical, though, because that's what's going to help us put it in the calculator. So the side length is going to be the cube root of 3,375. And then to actually evaluate that, I'm not really interested in doing that one in my head. I'm going to pull up my calculator. And to pull up a root other than the square root, I know most of you don't know where to find the square root, but to pull up something other than the square root, we're going to press the math key. And in this choice, I want you to notice that the fourth choice down the line is a cube root. And while we're here, I want you to notice that the fifth choice is x root. So there's a quick shortcut key on number 4 for the cube root, because it is still pretty common. And then if you want an even larger root than that, 4th, 5th, 8th root, then you can use choice 5. So we'll practice both of those throughout the day. But I'm going to go for the fourth choice here, which is finding the cube root. So if I press 4 on my calculator, it preps me here for that cube root. And our number was 3,375, I believe. Let's check. Yep. Okay. And then I just can hit enter. Just going to move this guy over. Hit enter. And there it is. So our cube root of 3,375 is exactly 15. And so I can come back here and conclude that the side length must be 15 inches. That'd be the side of them. Okay? Let's try one more. Let's try E here. And if you feel good about this, we'll move on. So we've got a volume of 125 over 8 cubic millimeters. We want to express the side length first as a cube root. So the side length will be the cube root of 125 over 8. And then we can throw that in the calculator to actually get an exact value of what that is. So we'll come here. Let's clear this out. We'll go back to math and choose the fourth choice, and then we can just put that right in there, 125 divided by 8. You could also use the fraction feature, but it's actually not necessary. You can just do the division mark, and that works too. So it looks like our side length is 2.5 millimeters. There you go. Okay, so make sure you write the cube root version first, and then you can evaluate that, or you can reach for the calculator for the harder ones. Okay? All right. So then let's talk a little bit about roots, because we're going to do two types of problems. Some of these problems are going to ask for all the real roots. And that's a really important distinction. That means we want every root, positive and negative, anything that's available or possible, any possible answer. And then there's other ones that just say, find the square root or find the radical root with the symbol itself. And usually, unless they say find all real roots, we're going to just focus on just the positive root and not worry about the negative option. So you'll see what I mean in just a moment. But before we talk about that, I just want to drive home a few things that help us kind of review later. So let n be an integer greater than 1. Okay, that's going to be your index or your the root at the top of your radical, and then a be a real number. So if you're finding an odd root, like we did just a moment ago, the cube root, or the fifth root, or the seventh root, right, then those guys only have one real root. And so if the index or the root up here is an odd number, then there's only one possible solution for that. Okay? If you're looking for an even root and a is positive, which is what that really means right there, then your solution or your radical will have two solutions. Okay? What that means is essentially, if I ask you to find the square root, all the real roots of 25, for example, the square root of 25, it's actually 5 and also negative 5. Both of those are real roots of 25 because 5 squared is 25 and negative 5 squared is also 25. So there's actually two numbers that square to give us 25. Right, so basically because this right here is true and this right here is also true, these are both considered roots, okay? Then the root of 25 is 5 and the root of 25 is also negative 5 because both of those values, when I square them, give me 25, okay? So if there's an even index, you know, value right up here, and this is positive, then you have two real answers. If this is even and a is zero, exactly zero, then it's exactly one solution and it's actually going to be zero. And most importantly, probably, if n is even and negative, your radicand is negative, and that has no real roots, that basically means that we can't take the square root or any even root of a number. Okay, like if I try to take the square root of 16, I'm asking what number times itself would give me a negative 16. That is not a real number, okay? It's not a real number. There's nothing I can multiply times its exact self and get a negative product. So that would have no real solutions. Okay. All right, so let's try that. So be careful when you're reading the directions because the distinction there is this particular detail, right? They want us to find the indicated real roots for A in these examples. So that means that we want to give all possible roots, not just the positive ones, okay? And when they say A and N, just remember what they're talking about there is they're calling N that root of the radical. Sometimes I call it the index also. A is your radicand, which is what I know it's underneath. And what you're trying to do is solve what that is, right? So like on number one, if we evaluate this guy right here, when they tell me that n is 2, that basically tells me I'm looking for a square root. I could not put anything here, or I could put a little 2 there if I want. And then my radicand is 64. And we're trying to find out what is the square root of 64, okay? Well, the square root of 64, again, it's an even n value, and 64 is positive, so because this guy is even, and because this is positive, this has two real roots. If they ask us for all the real roots, it has two real roots. And you can either write them separately, or you could put this symbol that you keep seeing me put, the plus minus, or the in front of it, and that implies that I'm talking about both. So you could write it both ways. And then what is the square root of 64? What number times itself gives us 64? Well, hopefully you know that one pretty well off the top of your head, and that's going to be 8. So the solution here, or the real roots here, are positive 8 and negative 8. You could write them together like that, which is nice as long as you don't forget the two signs. Or you could play it safe and just literally write them separately. It's 8 and negative 8. This guy right here, they want the cube root of 27. Okay, now if this is odd, then this only has one root. Okay? There's only one root. It's just what number times itself 3 times gives us 27, and that answer is 3. We actually had that example earlier. And that's the only root. There's no other options, okay? Because when you're multiplying 3 times, 3 times 3 times 3 would give us 27, but -3 times -3 times -3 would not give us 27. It would give us a negative 27. So that option is not available to us with odd indexes. All right, let's try maybe one more of these. This is the fourth route of 256. Okay, so this is even. And this guy is positive. And so this will have two roots, okay? And this one's a little bigger number. We might not know the answer off the top of that head. That's where we can grab the calculator. And this is a good example for us to show that other option. So what I'd like for you to do, this is the easiest way to do it, is put the root first. I want the fourth root, so write the number four. Then go to math and choose the fifth choice, right? So you can either choose a number five or highlight down to the five and hit enter and see how it turns that four into the root or the little index at the top left. Okay, and now I want the fourth root of 256. And that is exactly four. There it is. And I can come back here and be like, oh yeah, that's right, but it's positive or negative four. So I have two roots in this problem. I can write them like this, or I can write them separately. I just gotta make sure I have them both. Okay. So maybe press pause here, find the other three, and then you can pause. Okay, so check your answers. If you did those correctly, you should have only one root on number four, which was positive three. And then you should have two roots for number five, which is positive and negative two. And two roots for number six, which is positive and negative 10. Okay? All right, now, if the directions say real roots, then this is exactly what you're going to do. But most of the time, when we see the radical, unless they specify otherwise, it really indicates the positive root of A, okay? So we're gonna just worry about the positive roots for those even ones. Now, if the root is negative and that's the only one, that's fine. But the ones that have two options, like number seven, we're just gonna worry about writing the positive one, unless it specifically says write all the roots, okay? So like, for example, on number seven, they want the fourth root of 625. And again, we can grab our calculator. Let's try that again. We're gonna just write the index first, or the little root number, then press math. You can either scroll down or just press 5, and then we could do the 625 right there. Hit enter, and it looks like our root is 5. And again, if they didn't say all the real roots, then what we want is just the 5. Now, this is an odd one. So an odd one has only one solution, and you're going to give it. This does not have a positive option. This is a negative root. And it just basically is what number times itself three times gives you a negative 512. So let's practice that one. If you're not sure what that is, we can go to math. We can choose this fourth choice. And then we want to have our radicand be negative 512. And when we hit enter, it's negative 8. So it's negative 8 times negative 8 times negative 8. That gives us that result. And so that's the root. That's the cube root of negative 512. So it's really the even ones that have two options where we normally just gravitate toward the positive one unless the directions ask us for the others. So I'll let you guys work numbers 9, 10, and 11. If you want to check those later, we can do that in class. But I want to bring your attention to number 12, so check that one out. When you do number 12, guys, we're trying to take the root of, so this is even, of a negative number, and that, remember, has no real solution. You cannot take an even index of a negative number and get a real answer. And you can check that on the calculator all day, so let's try it. So if we try to take the square root and then we do a negative 81 in here, and we hit enter, it is going to give us an error message, and it says a non-real answer. So sorry. This is a non-real solution. It's not a real number. So that one, just wanted to bring that to your attention. That's a biggie. Always know that you can't take the even root of a negative number. All right. So then, let's talk about the next phase. So now that we know that there's more than just square roots out there and how to handle them, let's talk about rational exponents. So first of all, when you see rational, means that it means that it can be written as a fraction. So rational numbers are numbers that can be written as a fraction, okay? And to introduce these, the main concept, guys, is that a rational exponent or a fraction exponent is really the equivalent of a root, okay, of taking the radical. And so I always equate this to having just two options for writing the same thing, the same way that you have two options for writing decimals and fractions, right? So if I wanted to express 1/2, right, we know that we can write 1/2 as a fraction, or we can write 1/2 as 0.5. And they're both meaning exactly the same thing, we're just using different systems. One is a fraction, one is a decimal. Okay, well, same thing here. If I want to take the square root of a number, I have the option of writing that as a radical. So if I wanted to take the square root of something, I would do, oh, this is our radical form. In fact, I could do any root here, from a little. So that's radical form. And then I could express exactly the same thing by raising this to that fraction, where n, the root, is the denominator in that fraction. And I would basically be saying exactly the same thing, except in rational exponent form. And they're the same thing, just like fractions and decimals can be the same thing. Oh, that's an exponent. Hello. Y'all know what I mean. Let's try that again. My mind went off somewhere else. Exponent. Okay. All right. So these guys are equivalent. They're just two different forms or methods of writing the same thing. Okay. So let's practice a few of these. So the moral of the story is, guys, this is absolutely true. This is the big idea today, right here. Okay. These are equivalent. And the big thing is, if it's a root, it's going to be in your denominator. Okay. So if we still see a number in the numerator, kind of like right here, we see that 2. That still represents that exponent or power. So one way to think of this is, okay, if you look at this example right here, you've got 27 to the 2/3 power. Well, the 2 is still a power of 2. 3 is really multiplying by a third, right? So we know 2/3 is really 1/3 times 2. So we can separate those guys out so that we can kind of tackle each operation separately. So 2/3 is really 1/3 times 2. Okay, and then by separating and kind of tackle both things and say, oh, 27 to the 1/3, oh, that really means just the cube root of 27. That's what that means, right? So they want me to take the cube root of 27 and then square that answer. Got it, you know? And then we can even finish this out if we wanted to and say, oh, well, the cube root of 27 is just 3. And then 3 squared is 9. So this example that they didn't finish out really is equivalent to 9. So 27 to the 2/3 power, that's just 9, right? That's what we're going to do. So let's practice a couple of those. First, we're going to rewrite it in radical form, then we will solve it. So we're basically going to do this, and then we'll do that, okay? So let's try it on number 13. If I have 16 to the 3/4 power, I know I can rewrite that as 16 to the 1/4 cubed. I separate my fraction, I separate the denominator by doing 1/4 with the numerator, the 3. We know the power to power just lets us multiply those and still equivalent to 3/4. But then I can rewrite it in radical form like they asked me. So 16 to the 1/4 really means taking the 4th root of 16. So they want me to take the 4th root of 16 and then cube that. That's what our goal is. That's what our job. So the first part's done. This is me rewriting this in radical form. There it is. Step one. And then we'll go to the next phase of this, which is actually evaluating that. Well, the 4th root of 16, I happen to know, is 2. So that radical simplifies to 2. And then I can just cube that. 2 times 2 times 2. Oh, that's 8. And again, we'll be focused on positive roots right now, unless they specifically ask us otherwise. Let's try one more like that. So on number 14, you have 64 to the 3 over 2. So the first thing I'm going to do is separate those two operations out. I know that really means 64 to the 1/2 raised to the 3rd power. And that allows me to rewrite that in radical form. So 64 to the 1/4 is really just the square root of 64. So they want me to take the square root of 64 and cube it. That's what they're asking me to do. And then we, then, so that's step one, right? So this was rewriting unit radical form, done, right? And then proceed to evaluate, the square root of 64 is 8. So I know this radical simplifies to 8. And then 8 cubed is 512. And so there's that. And I know maybe you're like, oh, can I just put that in the calculator? Possibly, but you gotta show all that work anyway. So you do what you, you know, you can check your work for sure. But that is the actual value. That's the work I wanna see, sorry. That's the work I wanna see for credit. All right, try this last one, number 15, and then we can check it together in a moment. All right, so check if you got 128 on number 15, and the radical should be the 8th root of 256 raised to the 7th power. So when you rewrite it, it should be, that should be the radical form, and then when you evaluate it, you should get 128. So hopefully that was successful. All right, let's try a couple more. So in these, we're just going in the opposite direction. We're gonna rewrite these guys in rational exponents. We're gonna take them back, just practice taking them back to a fraction, and then evaluate it after that. So first thing I'm gonna do is, if I see that 5 is a root, right away I know I'm still taking that radicand, or that base of negative 32, and I'm raising it to the 3rd power, but then I wanna do the 5th root. So just remember, whatever this right here, that should end up in your denominator down there. Okay, so when I rewrite this, I can do it's negative 32 to the 3/5 power. And that's me rewriting that in rational exponent form. So that would be part one of this problem right here. And then I can evaluate it to get the answer. And you can do that on the calculator. So let's actually quit out of this. And we wanted to do, always put parentheses around your base. You got your 32 here. Negative 32, sorry, and then we're going to raise that, so do the little caret, and you can just put that fraction right in there. So it was 3/5, so we're going to do 3 divided by 5, and that's all going to, you can see it's all there in your exponent, hit enter, there's our solution. So negative 32 to the 3/5 power is just negative 8. So this results in negative 8. That's how it evaluates. Number 17. It's going to be rewritten. Again, the 6 stays on top. And the 3, which is the index of your radical, is going to go in the denominator. So this goes to 6/3. And actually, this is a great example. Something that looked a little intimidating there with the radical and the 3s and the 6, and I'm like, oh, 6 power. But really, when you rewrite it as an exponential form, what's 6 divided by 3 does? This exponent is really just going to simplify to 2. Boom. It's really 8. To the 2nd power. I should put that in parentheses. And so that's our exponential version of that. And then we all know 8 squared or 8 to the 2nd power is 64. So that's our solution there. Okay? You can try the last one on your own. We're just going to finish off with a word problem and then we're done. Okay? So the radius r of a sphere is given by that equation where A is a surface area. So A is surface area of the sphere. Okay, then they tell you that you have a surface area sphere with, well, so you have a sphere with a surface area of 2122.64. So that is our A value right there. They want you to find the radius of the sphere. So the nearest 10, using this guy, is pi. So all we have to do, this is just an application problem. You can see it's just really about entering the information. We're going to take the formula, but for A, we're going to plug in that 2122.64 over 4 times the pi, and all of that is going to be raised to the 1/2, which we know now is just the square root of that. And then we can evaluate, we can simplify this. I know that 4 times pi, or 4 times that 3.14, is just 12.56. here, and then when we just divide 2122.64 by that, it actually comes out, I think, pretty nice. Let's find out. So we've got 2122.64. We divide that by that 12.56, and all of a sudden, our base is just 169. Okay. So this really just becomes 169 to the 1/2. And if you're, you know, that really means just the square root of 169. So you can leave it like this, or you can rewrite it if you like this better. Either way, the square root of 169 is just 13. So the radius is just 13 meters. That's your R value right there. All right. I will see you guys next class. Have a great day.